Wrong concepts of God hinder us from walking as sons and daughters. Do you see God as disinterested? Do you see Him as a perfectionist? Do you see Him as a Santa Claus? These views hinder you from walking with God. Do you see Him as an angry judge? See, the Holy Spirit wants to change these misconceptions. Let's look at another misconception. Number 6, God is a control freak. In the sketch, you see God with the Christian is a puppet on a string, and God is saying, "Wee! Now let's see if we can make him do the hokey pokey." So this is the fear that God, if I give my life to him, he's going to control me. See, if your parents or an authority figure has attempted to control you, then you're going to be really leery about anyone, including God, trying to control you. By the way, control is not loving. God does not control, and love does not control. And someone that's been controlled, they tend to wall people off, and they take certain control of certain areas of their lives because they never want to be controlled again. I assure you tonight, God is not a controller. So one of my student leaders, he as he grew up, his mother would always say, "Ryan, you're an accident waiting to happen." And see, by her words, she was really cursing her son. And Ryan did have some difficulties. You know, he did tend to have accidents and things. And so as he became my student leader on the college campus, I started working with him about this wrong idea. And we began to challenge the lie that he is an accident waiting to happen. So one summer, I invited him to work with me on my painting crew. And so, because I wanted to have an opportunity to work with him, and it would be a great opportunity for me to disciple him in the marketplace. So he worked for me for the summer. So we were working on a mountain. We were working at a house that was on a sloping hill. And so the ladder setups were difficult. And so I helped the crew get some ladders set up. I went around the house, and as soon as I got around the house, I heard this crash, and I immediately knew what happened. A ladder had fallen, and it had broken a window. So I came back around. The first question I asked is, "Everybody all right?" And everybody said, "Yeah, I'm all right." And I saw it was Ryan's ladder. And so I pointed at Ryan. I said, "Ryan, you are not an accident waiting to happen. That was a difficult ladder setup. It could have happened to anyone." I said, "It's not your fault." And then his response was to say, "Well, Dick, I'll pay for it." And I said, "No, you won't pay for it. That was a work-related accident. It's part of the job. I will cover the cost." And so, you know, although it cost me several hundred dollars to replace the broken window, what I purchased was the truth that Ryan was not an accident waiting to happen. And it was well worth the money. And he's today serving the Lord. He's a good father. And he's overcoming this wrong idea that he's an accident waiting to happen. Father is the kindest person in the universe. And he wants you to know that he's not a control freak. Paul the Apostle called himself the bondservant of the Lord. And that's basically saying, "I've made myself the Lord's slave. He can tell me to do whatever he wants me to do." Why could Paul do that? It's because he trusted Jesus. He trusted the Heavenly Father. Because he's such a good father, I want to give my life fully to him. And he did so out of a sense of trust. The last concept of God is the concept that God is religious. In the sketch, we see God patting Susie Christian on the head, saying, "Yes, smashing performance on your prayers. Now off with you to do more good works and such." And Susie Christian says, "Yay, another gold star for me. I have so many more gold stars than anyone else." See, the view that God is religious means that he is pleased with outward performance. Isaiah speaks of this in Isaiah 29:11. where Isaiah says, these people honor me with their lips and their words, but their hearts are far from me. See, God is not interested in religious ritual. He's not interested in you going to church if your heart is not in it. He's not interested in you fasting if your heart is not in it. See, the world is really into religions where, well, if I do these certain religious things, then God is pleased with me. But see, in the biblical sense, God doesn't want just religious response. He wants heart-to-heart response to who He is. You know, I learned this really clearly when I became the father of my own children. My wife and I, we waited till our late 20s in order to have a family. And so by the time my wife conceived, we were ready, really ready to be parents. And this occurred in the early 1980s. And as my wife was going through her pregnancy, I read an interesting book called The Secret Life of the Unborn Child. And in this book, dated about 1982, researchers were doing studies and they were discovering that a child in the womb records and is aware of the circumstances around them, even before they're born into the world. And so what that spoke to me is that every child is like, every child is recording. They don't have a brain that's developed yet, so they're not intellectually doing this. But see, their spirit is recording everything. Things like how the mother feels about the pregnancy, even music and outside influences begin to mold and shape the child. That's what this research was showing. So after knowing this, I decided, well, I want to write some good messages on the heart of my new child. We didn't have a sonogram, so we didn't know what the gender was going to be. So I nicknamed my new child Pumpkin. So as my wife's pregnancy developed, I would talk to Pumpkin and I'd say, hello, Pumpkin, this is your dad. I love you. I can't wait till you come out. We're gonna have a great time together. And then as my wife's belly grew, I'd pound on her stomach and I'd say, hello, Pumpkin, this is your dad. So I was just having a great time as a pre-father. Well, the day of the birth came and we did a home birth, and I had the privilege of receiving my son as he was born into the world. You know, it's pretty easy. It's either A or B, so that's not real difficult. And I got to be the first hands to touch my son as he was born. And the very first thing my son did is he started peeing. So there's this little yellow fishing pole. And I said, we all systems are go, we have liftoff. And I was really excited. Of course, my wife didn't know the gender. So in my excitement, I said, joy, it's a boy. And my son was born. He came out with his face away from mine. But as soon as he heard that voice, he turned and he looked at me. And I'll never forget that. I'll never forget that little scrunched up face and those beautiful blue eyes looking in my direction. See, because he knew that voice. That was the voice of his father. And there was a bond created with my son at that moment that remains to this day. Even my children are well into they're grown up and they're way on their own. But see, that bond remains. Anyone that's been a parent knows this, that's like, I will do everything for my kids because I love them. See, they're mine. I had a hand in creating them. And I told my daughter that the same sort of thing happened 3 years later when she was born. And when my daughter came of age, I explained the facts of life to her. And I took her to a jewelry store and I said, now I want you to pick out any ring you want. And I want you to wear this ring as a promise ring because I want you to live God's way of righteousness. So she picked out a beautiful ring and she wore it. And then I told her, I said, now, I want you to live in purity, but if you ever get pregnant, I want to be the first to know because I'm your daddy and daddies take care of their daughters. See, I wasn't hoping she would get pregnant, but if that did happen, I wanted her to know that you can come home and I'm going to help you. I'm going to stand by you because that's what fathers do. And it's really through the process of parenting that I have I gained a fresh revelation of how much Father God loves me. The book of Isaiah tells us that God says, I've inscribed your name. I've tattooed your name on the palm of my hand. That's how precious each one of us are to the Father. And see, everything, every message in the world wants to mar that image. Satan, who is the ultimate abuser, he wants to destroy the image of God in your life. He wants to fill your mind with lies. He wants to feel like a bastard instead of an authentic son or daughter. And that's why we have to wage war against the enemy. And that's why we have to learn to take every thought captive to the obedience of Christ, so that every thought that we think is in conformity with truth. Now, I have an exercise for you that I'd like you to do. On the screen, I've placed a list of the 7 wrong concepts that we've looked at. And with each of those wrong concepts, I've listed a scripture of truth that neutralizes the lie. So what I'd like you to do now is I'd like you to identify 1 or 2 of those wrong concepts that you would say, yeah, I really see some of that in my life. And then I'd like you to pair up with a friend, and I'd like you to share your wrong concepts with each other. And then I'd like you to pray over each other and ask the Father to come and to begin to heal the distorted images. And then the final thing I'd like you to do is I'd like you to read Psalms 103 over each other out loud. That means person 1, you read Psalms 103 over person 2. Then when that's done, person 2, you read Psalms 103 over person 1. Psalms 103 is a psalm of identity, and it's a psalm of how the Father sees you.